can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.
Psychologists define memory as the persistence of learning over time.
Human memory occurs in three distinct stages: encoding, storage, and retrieval. The first step to memory is encoding, and this is the process by which information gets into memory storage. When you're listening to music, or listening to a lecture, or reading a book, you're encoding the information into memory. This process is using sensations to take information in through your eyes or your ears or other senses, and then perception to be able to categorize it in a meaningful way for you. Storage is the process by which we retain information and later are able to access it. So storage is essentially the process by which we keep information for later usage. Retrieval is the process by which we go and get that information and we use it. So once we've encoded something, we can then put it away for later use and retrieve it when we need it. To begin the process of memory encoding, we must use our attention. Attention is selective in the respect that there are many things that are happening at any given time, but we're only paying attention or specifically looking and perceiving things that we deem to be important. For example, right now you're listening to the sound of my voice and maybe you're looking at the computer screen or your phone screen, but you're actually taking in a lot more information. You're taking in smells, you're looking at things that possibly aren't on the screen, but you're still visually taking them in, but you're only paying attention, hopefully, to the things that you feel to be important. There are two major types of attention that we'll look at here: divided attention and sustained attention. Divided attention is concentrating on more than one activity at the same time, like when you're listening to music but also having a conversation with somebody. Sustained attention, which is also known as vigilance, is the ability to maintain your attention to a selected stimulus for a prolonged period of time. For example, if you're trying to study for a midterm or a final, you are using the application of sustained attention. Let's take a look at attention a little more deeply. I'm going to do a short little thought experiment with you. I want you to watch the following video and simply follow the directions that the video tells you to do. At the end, I want you to take a moment and just jot down the answer to the question that they give you.
Count how many times the players wearing white pass the ball.
On a scrap piece of paper, write down how many passes you got. Don't cheat off anybody. This is just a look at attention. Did you get 16? Congratulations. You counted correctly. But did you notice anything weird in that video? If you're like nearly 50% of participants, you missed a couple of very significant things. Would you believe that if you didn't see anything peculiar in that video, that in the middle of that video, a man in a gorilla costume entered stage left, walked in the middle, pounded his chest, and then walked off stage right, all while you didn't notice? But you were paying attention, right? So statistically, about 50% of you are feeling pretty smug right now. You saw the monkey. It was pretty obvious. But did you notice anything else in that video that was weird? Watch the curtain in the background. Notice how it starts a deep red, and now it's turning to a burnt orange? How in the heck did you miss something so blatant? So luckily, we didn't miss anything else in that video. What if I showed you that right under your nose, one of the girls in black disappeared, never to be heard from again? Feel bad? What in the heck is going on here? Half of you didn't see a man in a gorilla costume walk in the middle of these girls, pound his chest, and leave. Others of you didn't see a magical curtain that could change colors. And still others of you just didn't mind that out of 6 girls, only 5 survived the gorilla showing up. Isn't that a problem? Actually, no. You did exactly what you were instructed to do. If you got around 16 passes, that was what you were instructed to do, and you used your sustained attention or your vigilance to maintain attention to the selected stimulus. Your divided attention isn't nearly as good, and therefore we shouldn't fault you very much if you didn't see the gorilla, or you didn't see the girl disappear, or you didn't see the curtain change colors. Nothing really jumped out at you because you were paying attention, and your sustained attention was really good. But ask yourself, have you ever thought to yourself that you're really good at multitasking? What do you think about that now? Might you miss the gorilla standing right in front of you?
I'd like to tell you about a legal case that I worked on involving a man named Steve Titus. Titus was a restaurant manager. He was 31 years old. He lived in Seattle, Washington. He was engaged to Gretchen, about to be married. She was the love of his life. And one night, the couple went out for a romantic restaurant meal. They were on their way home, and they were pulled over by a police officer. You see, Titus's car sort of resembled a car that was driven earlier in the evening by a man who raped a female hitchhiker. And Titus kind of resembled that rapist. So the police took a picture of Titus, they put it in a photo lineup, they later showed it to the victim, and she pointed to Titus's photo, she said, "That one's the closest." The police and the prosecution proceeded with a trial, and when Steve Titus was put on trial for rape, the rape victim got on the stand and said, "I'm absolutely positive that's the man." And Titus was convicted. He proclaimed his innocence. His family screamed at the jury. His fiancée collapsed on the floor sobbing, and Titus is taken away to jail. So what would you do at this point? What would you do? Well, Titus lost complete faith in the legal system, and yet he got an idea. He called up the local newspaper. He got the interest of an investigative journalist, and that journalist actually found the real rapist, a man who ultimately confessed to this rape, a man who was thought to have committed 50 rapes in that area, and when this information was given to the judge set Titus free. And really, that's where this case should have ended. It should have been over. Titus should have thought of this as a horrible year, a year of accusation and trial, but over. It didn't end that way. Titus was so bitter. He'd lost his job. He couldn't get it back. He lost his fiancée. She couldn't put up with his persistent anger. He lost his entire savings, and so he decided to file a lawsuit against the police and others whom he felt were responsible for his suffering. And that's when I really started working on this case, trying to figure out, how did that victim go from "that one's the closest" to "I'm absolutely positive that's the guy"? Well, Titus was consumed with his civil case as he spent every waking moment thinking about it, and just days before he was to have his day in court, he woke up in the morning, doubled over in pain, and died of a stress-related heart attack. He was 35 years old. So I was asked to work on Titus's case because I'm a psychological scientist. I study memory. I've studied memory for decades. And if I meet somebody on an airplane This happened on the way over to Scotland. If I meet somebody on an airplane and we ask each other, what do you do, what do you do? And I say, I study memory. They usually want to tell me how they have trouble remembering names, or they've got a relative who's got Alzheimer's or some kind of memory problem. But I have to tell them, I don't study when people forget. I study the opposite, when they remember. When they remember things that didn't happen, or remember things that were different from the way they really were. I study false memories. Unhappily, Steve Titus is not the only person to be convicted based on somebody's false memory. In one project in the United States, information has been gathered on 300 innocent people, 300 defendants who were convicted of crimes they didn't do. They spent 10, 20, 30 years in prison for these crimes, and now DNA testing has proven that they're actually innocent. And when those cases have been analyzed, 3/4 of them are due to faulty memory, faulty eyewitness memory. Well, why? Like the jurors who convicted those innocent people and the jurors who convicted Titus, many people believe that memory works like a recording device. You just record the information, then you call it up and play it back when you want to answer questions or identify images. But decades of work in psychology has shown that this just isn't true. Our memories are constructive. They're reconstructive. Memory works a little bit more like a Wikipedia page. You can go in there and change it, but so can other people. I first started studying this constructive memory process in the 1970s. I did my experiments that involved showing people simulated crimes and accidents and asking them questions about what they remember. In one study, we showed people a simulated accident, and we asked people how fast were the cars going when they hit each other. And we asked other people how fast were the cars going when they smashed into each other. And if we asked the leading smash question, the witnesses told us the cars were going faster. And moreover, that leading smashed question caused people to be more likely to tell us that they saw broken glass in the accident scene when there wasn't any broken glass at all. In another study, we showed a simulated accident where a car went through an intersection with a stop sign, and if we asked a question that insinuated it was a yield sign, many witnesses told us they remember seeing a yield sign at the intersection, not a stop sign. And you might be thinking, well, you know, these are filmed events, they're not particularly stressful. Would the same kind of mistakes be made with a really stressful event? In a study we published just a few months ago, we have an answer to this question. Because what was unusual about this study is we arranged for people to have a very stressful experience. The subjects in the study were members of the US military who were undergoing a harrowing training exercise to teach them what it's going to be like for them if they are ever captured as prisoners of war. And as part of this training exercise, these soldiers are interrogated in an aggressive, hostile, physically abusive fashion for 30 minutes. And later on, they have to try to identify the person who conducted that interrogation. And when we feed them suggestive information that insinuates it's a different person, many of them misidentify their interrogator, often identifying someone who doesn't even remotely resemble the real interrogator. And so what these studies are showing is that when you feed people misinformation about some experience that they may have had, you can distort or contaminate or change their memory. Well, out there in the real world, misinformation is everywhere. We get misinformation not only if we're questioned in a leading way, but if we talk to other witnesses who might consciously or inadvertently feed us some erroneous information, or if we see media coverage about some event we might have experienced. all of these provide the opportunity for this kind of contamination of our memory. In the 1990s, we began to see an even more extreme kind of memory problem. Some patients were going into therapy with one problem. Maybe they had depression, eating disorder, and they were coming out of therapy with a different problem. Extreme memories for horrific brutalization, sometimes in satanic rituals, sometimes involving really bizarre and unusual elements. One woman came out of psychotherapy believing that she'd endured years of ritualistic abuse where she was forced into a pregnancy and that the baby was cut from her belly. But there were no physical scars or any kind of physical evidence that could have supported her story. And when I began looking into these cases, I was wondering, where do these bizarre memories come from? And what I found is that most of these situations involved some particular form of psychotherapy. And so I asked, were some of the things going on in this psychotherapy, like the imagination exercises, or dream interpretation, or in some cases hypnosis, or in some cases exposure to false information, were these leading these patients to develop these very bizarre, unlikely memories? And I designed some experiments to try to study the processes that were being used in this psychotherapy so I could study the development of these very rich false memories. In one of the first studies we did, we used suggestion, a method inspired by the psychotherapy we saw in these cases. We used this kind of suggestion and planted a false memory that when you were a kid, 5 or 6 years old, you were lost in a shopping mall. You were frightened, you were crying, you were ultimately rescued by an elderly person and reunited with the family. And we succeeded in planting this memory in the minds of about a quarter of our subjects. And you might be thinking, well, that's not particularly stressful. But we and other investigators have planted rich false memories of things that were much more unusual and much more stressful. So in a study done in Tennessee, researchers planted the false memory that when you were a kid, you nearly drowned and had to be rescued by a lifeguard. And in a study done in Canada, researchers planted the false memory that when you were a kid, something as awful as being attacked by a vicious animal happened to you, succeeding with about half of their subjects. And in a study done in Italy, researchers planted the false memory, when you were a kid, you witnessed demonic possession. I do want to add that it might seem like we are traumatizing these experimental subjects in the name of science, but our studies have gone through thorough evaluation by research ethics boards that have made the decision that the temporary discomfort that some of these subjects might experience in these studies is outweighed by the importance of this problem for understanding memory processes and the abuse of memory that is going on in some places in the world. Well, to my surprise, when I published this work and began to speak out against this particular brand of psychotherapy, it created some pretty bad problems for me. Hostilities primarily from the repressed memory therapists who felt under attack and by the patients whom they had influenced. I had sometimes armed guards at speeches that I was invited to give, people trying to drum up letter writing campaigns to get me fired. But probably the worst was I suspected that a woman was innocent of abuse that was being claimed by her grown daughter. She accused her mother of sexual abuse based on a repressed memory. And this accusing daughter had actually allowed her story to be filmed and presented in public places. I was suspicious of this story, and so I started to investigate and eventually found information that convinced me that this mother was innocent. I published an exposé on the case, and a little while later, The accusing daughter filed a lawsuit. Even though I'd never mentioned her name, she sued me for defamation and invasion of privacy. And I went through nearly 5 years of dealing with this messy, unpleasant litigation. But finally, it was over and I could really get back to my work. In the process, however, I became part of a disturbing trend in America where scientists are being sued for simply speaking out on matters of great public controversy. When I got back to my work, I asked this question. If I plant a false memory in your mind, does it have repercussions? Does it affect your later thoughts, your later behaviors? Our first study planted a false memory that you got sick as a child, eating certain foods, hard-boiled eggs, dill pickles, strawberry ice cream, and we found that once we planted this false memory, people didn't want to eat the foods as much at an outdoor picnic. The false memories aren't necessarily bad or unpleasant. If we planted a warm, fuzzy memory involving a healthy food like asparagus, we could get people to want to eat asparagus more. And so what these studies are showing is that you can plant false memories and they have repercussions that affect behavior long after the memories take hold. Well, along with this ability to plant memories and control behavior, obviously come some important ethical issues. Like, when should we use this mind technology and should we ever ban its use? Therapists can't ethically plant false memories in the mind of their patients, even if it would help the patient. But there's nothing to stop a parent from trying this out on their overweight or obese teenager. And when I suggested this publicly, it created outcry again. There she goes. She's advocating that parents lie to their children. Hello, Santa Claus. I mean, another way another way to think about this is, which would you rather have? A kid with obesity, diabetes, shortened lifespan, all the things that go with it, or a kid with one little extra bit of false memory? I know what I would choose for a kid of mine. But maybe my work has made me different from most people. Most people cherish their memories, know that they represent their identity, who they are, where they came from. And I appreciate that. I feel that way too. But I know from my work how much fiction is already in there. If I've learned anything from these decades of working on these problems, it's this. Just because somebody tells you something and they say it with confidence, just because they say it with lots of detail, just because they express emotion when they say it, it doesn't mean that it really happened. We can't reliably distinguish true memories from false memories. We need independent corroboration. Such a discovery has made me more tolerant of the everyday memory mistakes that my friends and family members make. Such a discovery might have saved Steve Titus, the man whose whole future was snatched away by a false memory. But meanwhile, we should all keep in mind, we do well to, that memory, like liberty, is a fragile thing. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Human memory has three different levels of processing, from shallow to intermediate to deep. Shallow processing looks at physical and perceptual features, like what a car looks like, and what are the shapes and angles of a particular object. Intermediate processing is where we recognize a particular stimulus and we can label it, such as the recognition that all of these different things make up a car. So it's not just the lines and not just the colors, but we put them together holistically and we get the concept of car. Deep processing gets into semantic and meaningful characteristics, and even symbolic characteristics. Things that are associated with cars are brought to mind when you see a car. Like, you see a Porsche and you think about a movie that you saw a Porsche in. Or you see a Ferrari and you think about a car that is really fast. Or you see a car that looks like the very first car that you owned and you start to think about memories of high school or college or whenever you got your first car. Memory storage encompasses how information is retained over time and how it is represented in the memory. Sensory memory holds information from the world in its original sensory form for only an instant, not much longer than the brief time it's exposed to the visual, auditory, or other senses. Sensory memory is very rich and detailed, but we lose information quickly. We take information in through sensory input, and it stays in our sensory memory for about a half a second. If the information is within our attention, it goes to our short-term memory, where it can stay for approximately 5 to 6 seconds. If it's rehearsed, if you practice it over and over in your conscious mind, you can keep it in your short-term memory a little bit longer. But if we look at the history of research within memory, we can see that the best of us can retain about 7 pieces of information in our short-term memory. The researcher who came up with this idea was George Miller, and he came up with what's called the magic number 7, plus or minus 2, which means that most people can retain between 5 and 9 pieces of information in our short-term memory without losing it in that 5 to 7 seconds. Once those pieces of short-term memory go through the consolidation process, they are encoded into our long-term memory, where they are stored and retrieved as we need them.
Flatter myself. I think I'm going to be able to play it that fast, and I actually can't. So take it from your introduction again after the 3 chords, a little slower.
If you ever want to treat yourself to something wonderful, type in the name Adler and the word harmonica on YouTube. This is from an Australian program called Four Corners from 1961. There are 100 videos like this.
Do people take you seriously with this instrument?
Oh, what a nasty question. I do. Oh, I take myself so seriously.
Oh, you take yourself seriously, but do others?
Well, if Vaughan Williams writes for the mouth organ, he's not doing this for a joke.
My name is Malcolm Gladwell. You're listening to Revisionist History, my podcast about things overlooked and misunderstood. This is the first of 2 episodes about memory, about the myths we hold about it and the games our memories play. This one is about an argument between 2 old friends over what supposedly happened or did not happen during a raid on a house supposedly full of Nazis in July 1945. Or maybe April of 1946. I have no idea.
This is an interview with Larry Adler by Dorothy Horowitz on February the 5th, 1986. And Larry Adler is the virtuoso hand organ player. Is that correct title?
Did you say hand organ?
Mouth organ.
Because the hand organ is what you grind from monkeys.
Right, you are.
By the time Larry Adler sat down to tell his life story to a historian with the American Jewish Committee, his reputation was well known.
Perfectly all right with me.
No. Mouth organ player, or harmonica player, as it is also known.
I use the word mouth organ, but the people who manufacture it call it a harmonica.
Harmonica. And I might add a raconteur par excellence, and we hope you're going to indulge in a lot of that, because we're going to want to know all about you.
Of course, you know that raconteur is a very polite word for liar.
Raconteur is a very polite word for liar. That could easily be on Larry Adler's tombstone. Larry Adler was the greatest harmonica player in the world. Your grandparents would know exactly who he was. I have to admit, I'd never heard of him until I was rooting around one day in the oral history archives at the New York Public Library. I ran across his interview, listened to it for a few moments, and was about to give up when Adler began to tell the story of his affair with Ingrid Bergman, back when she was considered the most beautiful actress in the world. They met while Adler was on tour at the end of the Second World War, entertaining the troops in Europe. Late one night, he's in a bar in Augsburg, Germany, playing the piano.
And she came into the room where I was playing, liked what I was playing, asked me what it was. I said, it was something I made up. And she said, have you written it down? I said, no, I can't write music. And she said, you're very smug, aren't you? You're not only ignorant, you're proud of your ignorance. That's how I met Ingrid Bergman.
Adler tells his interviewer that he'd just recently read a biography of Bergman in which Bergman's husband claimed that he, Larry Adler, had come to him and confessed their affair.
I know I wouldn't have done such a thing because I wouldn't have done that to Ingrid. I wouldn't have named what was happening to her husband. However, it is in the book, and I can't deny that he said that to the author of the book. But as I say, I can't see me doing it. It is against my nature and my principles.
Just to be clear, Larry Adler was having an affair with one of the most famous actresses in the world. And the actress's husband says Adler confessed it to him. You would think that would be a memorable event. But Adler's response is, maybe. I guess it could have happened.
By the way, in War and Peace, and I'm paraphrasing, of course, because you can't remember Tolstoy word for word, there's a sequence where a young man who's been at a battle, I think the Battle of Borodino, is in Moscow in a drawing room telling these very attractive young ladies about his war experiences. But he was behind the lines. He didn't see action. He only heard about action from other soldiers. But he saw that he was losing his audience because he couldn't give them any tales of battle action. So he began to use the stories that other soldiers had told him, but making it personal as if he had experienced that action. And then Tolstoy has a line very much like this. And he realized as he spoke that the truth was slipping away from him, and soon he would no longer know what the truth was. Now, I think that applies very much to anybody telling any story about anything.
The officer in Tolstoy's War and Peace tells a story that isn't true, and from then on forgets that it isn't true. Larry Adler doesn't call the officer a liar or say he shouldn't make things up. Adler says that's the way memories work. They're up for grabs. In fact, throughout the oral history, Adler keeps summoning memories and simultaneously discounting them until he has completely convinced you that that's the way we all ought to act. The interview culminates in the story of the raid on the Munich boarding house full of Nazis with his old friend, the dashingly handsome spy named Hans Werner, a.k.a. John Weitz. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. Larry Adler was born in Baltimore in 1914 to Jewish immigrants from Ukraine. His dad was a plumber. At the age of two, he wandered away from home and was later found at a local bar standing on top of a pool table and singing I've Got the Profiteering Blues to wild applause. He was a prodigy. At 14, he took his harmonica on the train to New York City and talked his way into performing on Broadway.
I passed the Paramount Theater, and Rudy Vallée's name was on the marquee.
Rudy Vallée was basically the Jay-Z of the 1920s.
So I got off the streetcar, sneaked past the stage door man, found Rudy Vallée, and started to play for him. And he interrupted me. He said, look, I'm just a master of ceremonies here, kid. I'm not an agent.
Vallée put him on that very night. It was obvious even then that Adler was something special. He had perfect pitch, an astounding musical memory. He could make the harmonica sing in a way that no one else has ever done. If you watch any of those old videos of Adler on YouTube, he's mesmerizing. Slender, long, thin fingers, huge forehead, oversized eyes. There's a wonderful story about him in The New Yorker in 1942, which describes him as resembling a very young and slightly sinister kitten. Once, when he's living in Beverly Hills, Adler gets a call from Charlie Chaplin. Chaplin says, please come over and make a fourth for tennis because Bill Tilden can't make it. Bill Tilden, arguably the greatest tennis player of all time after Roger Federer. Adler goes over. There's a woman there with badly combed hair and black sneakers and a man with a weird mustache. They hit for a while and he realizes, oh, the woman is Greta Garbo and the man with the weird mustache, Salvador Dali. Tilden, Garbo, Dali, Chaplin. This kind of thing happens to Adler all the time. He wanted to subtitle his autobiography, Name Drops Keep Falling on My Head. He was friends with the legendary composer Frank Lesser, but he hated Lesser's wife, whom he called, wait for it, the evil of two Lessers. I mean, how much do you love this guy?
Prince Philip wrote me a wonderful letter when my father died from Buckingham Palace and said, you know, how close they were.
That's Peter Adler, Larry's son. Prince Philip, of course, is the Queen's husband.
Well, they were both members of an infamous club called the Thursday Club. And I think there were only 13 members. And they would meet every other Thursday at Wheeler's Restaurant and all get very drunk and tell tales and whatever they did. And we were living in Grosvenor Square at the time. And in the middle of the afternoon, my father arrives without warning, totally drunk with Prince Philip. They'd come straight from a Thursday Club lunch. And the fact that my father had never given my mother any warning, he was arriving with the Duke of Edinburgh. I don't think she forgave him.
But the greatest Larry Adler story comes earlier. Adler is in Germany, entertaining the American troops. He's touring with Jack Benny, one of the most famous entertainers of the day, and Ingrid Bergman, who he's just met at the piano bar in Augsburg and is possibly already sleeping with.
And the story is, Jack Benny, Ingrid Bergman, and I were in Munich, July 1945, and we met this young man, John Weitz, who was the commander of an OSS unit.
John Weitz, the second old friend in this story. From the 1960s to the 1980s, John Weitz was a successful high-end men's fashion designer. He made the kind of clothes you would put in an overnight bag before jumping on the Concorde to make a lunch date at the Savoy in London. In shirts, Weitz favored what was known as the European cut, which, as a fashion critic once wrote, disqualified anyone without a perfectly flat stomach. Weitz was 6'2", insanely handsome, raced sports cars at Le Mans and Sebring, wrote best-selling thrillers and scholarly biographies, educated in exclusive English boarding schools, aristocratic bearing, married to a stunning actress, Susan Conner. He was basically James Bond.
What was the world that your father and mother inhabited in sort of 60s and 70s New York?
It was a pretty, kind of beautiful people set.
That's John Weitz's son, Chris. He and his brother, Paul, are both filmmakers in Los Angeles.
There's a book called The Beautiful People in which my parents are featured along with the rest of their bunch.
You've probably seen some of the Weitz brothers' films, About a Boy, The Exquisite in Good Company, American Pie. If you're wondering, their father was a big fan of American Pie.
But our dad really loved it.
He loved it.
He
defended it.
He defended it against all comers.
So I remember him saying that he was in a coffee shop and some old guy said to him, well, sarcastically, I bet you're really proud of your kids for making this horrible film. And he said, I don't know where he came up with this, but he said, haven't you ever masturbated in your life?
John Weitz was German, born in Berlin in 1923 as Hans Werner Weitz. He was also Jewish, and of that class of wealthy assimilated German Jews for whom those two identities were not a contradiction. His father, Robert, had fought for Germany in the First World War and won an Iron Cross.
Vacations in the north of Germany and kind of a beautiful life.
Then Hitler took power. Weitz's family fled in 1938, then on to Shanghai, where he waited for his American visa and played rugby on the side. And finally, to America in 1941. John Weitz joins the U.S. Army and gets recruited by the legendary wartime spymaster Wild Bill Donovan into the OSS, the forerunner of today's CIA. Then he's sent back into occupied Europe as an undercover spy because, of course, he doesn't have to pretend to be German. He's actually German. He's dropped into France, makes contact with the resistance. He's part of the group that liberated one of the most infamous concentration camps, Dachau.
He told me about a... when he was in Dachau, seeing a gas chamber, and there was a little window whereby the operator could tell whether the people inside were dead or not, and next to it was a picture of his little child. He described it as being the way that a taxi driver would have a picture of his family and children like taped to the dashboard. But that really stuck with him.
After the war, Dachau was turned into a holding pen for prisoners of war. Weitz was sent into the camp to spy on the captured German soldiers, to impersonate a German POW. Some German soldiers, after the war ended, would burn off their SS tattoos with the end of a cigarette. Weitz got a tattoo and then burned himself as well to make the impersonation real.
Now you'd say he had PTSD, actually. But nobody talked about it in that way. So he was, a drinker, not a sloppy one, but someone who sort of regularly, until he suddenly cut it off like cold turkey at some point in our childhood. He didn't sleep well. He woke up very early in the morning. He had incredibly regular habits born of the army, of kind of keeping things in order. He was, if he was crossed by a stranger, if someone was rude to him or impolite, he would be very scary and dangerous. He definitely seemed, from the war, someone who had no physical fear of other people. And that was really scary as a child to watch.
Weitz told his sons that he didn't know whether he could ever be a good father. The war had changed him too much.
Chris and I used to talk about our childhood as growing up in a behind the Iron Curtain. Like you had to have sort of surreptitious modes of self-expression, and humor was a big aspect of that.
Well, like the fact that we ended up working together is partly because we sort of developed this shared sense of humor, and it was kind of like a samizdat method of maintaining our autonomy with a very sort of domineering dad who was always ready for things to lapse into complete
disaster. Oh, I see. Yeah.
A dad who was always ready for things to lapse into catastrophe. Back to Munich. The war has just ended. Weitz is now running an undercover operation against a German guerrilla group called Werewolf. It's made up of ex-Nazi soldiers who were causing trouble across liberated Europe. A werewolf cell had holed up in a Munich rooming house, not far from the Deutsche Theater. John Weitz has infiltrated the group under the name Hans Werner. Then word comes in from the Allied brass, round up the werewolf members. And just as the order is issued, Weitz runs into Larry Adler, Ingrid Bergman, and Jack Benny.
And he said that they had found the house where they knew there were 8 German soldiers. Now, the war was over. Therefore, these soldiers had neither surrendered nor been captured. John and his OSS unit were going to raid them. And would Jack, Ingrid, and I like to come along? Well, Jack and Ingrid refused. They were terrified of the idea. I loved it.
Now, let's just pause here while I point out the obvious. A 20-something John Weitz, the dashingly handsome undercover spy, runs into, respectively, America's most famous actress, America's most famous comedian, and the world's greatest harmonica player, presumably at a nightclub. And he invites all 3 of them to join him in raiding a house full of Nazi guerrillas. And one of them, the skinny harmonica player from Baltimore, says yes. The Weitz brothers, disciples of Hollywood, do not find this as odd as I did.
Does it strike you? One of the many weird things with that story is the notion that you are an OSS officer in Munich. You're going to do this bust, and you bring along a famous harmonica player.
What's strange about that?
Well, I guess it's a testament to the power of celebrity.
It's kind of like a ride-along, you know? Like Kevin Hart and Ice Cube.
So Larry Adler prepares for his mission. I'm guessing he's lying in the arms of the world's most beautiful actress. He gets up, puts on a helmet, and goes off to capture some Nazis.
So I met these OSS men at 4:30 in the morning. We got into a Jeep, went to this house, and according to John, the OSS men burst into the house. 2 of the Germans fired back at them and were killed. The other 6 were captured.
Key phrase, according to John. John Weitz remembers a gunfight, but Adler remembers something completely different.
My story is, when we got into the house, there were 2 old ladies.
There was no firing. No one was hurt in any way. And so there are these two diametrically opposed stories by two people who were there.
In John White's memory, a house full of Nazis, a nasty battle, death, drama. In Larry Adler's memory, of the same night, nothing. No Nazis, no gunfight, no one dies. They burst in, and all they find is a room full of harmless old women, presumably knitting. But wait, there's another version. Same characters, same setup, only it's supposed to take place almost a year later, in April of 1946.
I told this story to a group of publishers in London when I made a speech, and one of the publishers told me afterward, "Mr. Adler, did you know that the raid you're talking about is mentioned in another book? And John White is mentioned, but not by name. He's called Werner, because that was his name as an agent to infiltrate the German lines. John, under the name of Werner, is leading the raid. You are with him. And now there are 18 Nazi soldiers. The house is surrounded by armored carriers and floodlights. And I still remember two old ladies." So the question is, who is right?
Exactly. Who's right? For the rest of their days, Adler and Weitz will argue about it.
I remember Larry bringing up the story to Needle Dad.
And my dad, the funny thing is, my father could be very, very forbidding and peremptory with people who sort of crossed him. For some reason, he had a soft spot for Larry.
Everyone had a soft spot for Larry.
What I heard at lunch was, you were rounding up these Nazis, and all I saw was old women. Oh, Larry.
Yeah, it was something.
Shut up and have another champagne.
There's a very specific idea about memory embedded in the story Larry Adler tells from War and Peace. The story about the soldier entertaining a group of young ladies in Moscow and the Battle of Borodino. The officer wants to impress the people around him, so he moves himself to the front lines, and once he makes that improvement on the truth in the service of his own ego, what actually happens slips away. He becomes the victim of his own self-deception. That's the theory Adler believed in. He tells another story about the time he was in Newfoundland during the war, entertaining troops. He needs to get back to Gander Airport because he has a nightclub appearance scheduled in New York. He finds an airman who has a cargo plane which is going to be towing a glider. And he says to Adler, "You can ride in the glider."
I was in the glider. The captain was in the front plane, and how exciting it was for me being in the glider, being towed, and how the most exciting part came when we were over Gander Airport and he cut the glider loose by a release mechanism and we floated down in this heavenly feeling I had of escape that I never wanted to land.
Adler tells that story for years.
Well, my daughter found a diary. It covered my trip to Newfoundland. I wasn't in the glider. I was in the front plane. Now you see how that took over. It's a better story being in the glider. It makes it. If you say to somebody, "I was in the first front plane, but we were towing a glider," that's no story. You see, I was in the glider, and that was very exciting. That's more of a story. So that after a while, the wish to be in the glider took over and became fact and put me in the glider. And the truth is that I've never been in a glider in my life. That's what I mean by self-deception.
Adler knew he had a big ego, and he simply assumed that his ego was out in the world rewriting history on his behalf. Which seems to make sense. Adler is the compulsive storyteller, right? The name dropper. In his New Yorker profile, there's this line, "The most casual request for information from a newspaper reporter or interviewer will often bring in reply a 12 or 15 typewritten single-space narrative composed and typed by Larry in person and containing dialogue and anecdotes." I think that whenever we run across someone telling a false story, we assume that this is what's happening, that the lie is driven by ego. In the next episode, I'm going to talk about an incident that you'll almost certainly remember, a modern version of Adler's glider story. Somebody famous was caught saying, in effect, that they were in the glider when they were actually in the plane pulling the glider. And the overwhelming assumption was that the storyteller changed the details of what happened because he wanted to look better, braver, bolder. But here's my question. Why do we always have to frame memory disagreements and errors in terms of character? Why do we always need a culprit? Because I'm not sure Adler can be explained away as an egotist. There were all kinds of ways in which he was anything but.
At what point, I know life became somewhat complicated here.
Adler was part of a group that went to Washington in the middle of the McCarthy era to protest the anti-communist hysteria sweeping through Hollywood. Then he got accused of being a communist. He went bankrupt fighting McCarthyism. At the height of his career, he was blacklisted, lost everything.
Then Roy Cohn, who was McCarthy's advisor, offered me a deal. He had arranged that I would give testimony secretly before the McCarthy Internal Security Committee. And he said, what we're going to do is I prepared a list of names for you. All of these people have been named by others. They've already been named. We know their names. You just read their names off and you're not hurting anybody.
In the middle of a national hysteria, one that would end up ruining countless lives, Adler is offered a get-out-of-jail-free card. He won't take it.
And I said, Mr. Cohn, what the hell is the sense of me reading a list of names that you already know? So he looked out of the window and he spread his hands and he says, go fight City Hall. We're all trying to get you back to work, Larry, and you're not helping us. Yeah. So that was that. I wouldn't have given the name of an enemy. I just am against the principle of the informer. I always have been, I still am.
Adler ended up moving his whole family to London. He gave up their house in Beverly Hills, the beach house in Malibu, the tennis matches with the stars, started over. Chris White says his father liked Adler not just because of his musical genius or his hilarious stories, but because he had, and I'm quoting, a major set of balls. Here's Peter Adler again.
He would really take huge risks on principle. He was a very, very principled man. And I remember him doing it, which terrified me. He did a public reading of the Satanic Verses with various other artists at the time that Salman Rushdie had the fatwa put on him, you know, simply to protest against this kind of nonsense. And he would do a lot of things like that. And he wasn't doing it for publicity. He's doing it because he really cared about it.
So maybe when the young John Weitz asks Larry Adler if he wants to do a ride-along on that raid in Munich, it's not a lark. Maybe he's serious. And maybe Adler volunteered because it was important. Remember, he's a Jew, in Munich, the birthplace of the Nazi Party. If it's all a lark, then the grandmother version is funny. It's the kind of punchline you can imagine landing well at a Hollywood dinner party. Larry Adler, the compulsive storyteller, wins over another crowd. But if he's serious about the raid, then the grandmothers aren't funny. They're not a punchline. They're a sad and awkward ending.
My story is duller. One would never even tell such a story. And I would tell it only because that is my memory of it.
He's right. But then consider his companion. John Weitz would go on to write many books, among them, Friends in High Places, a thriller with a really complicated core.
The main character was somebody who was in the auto industry and was joining the Nazi Party in order to get ahead in his career. I think he felt about himself that if he hadn't been Jewish, maybe there, but for the grace of God, would go his moral center.
When John Weitz turned to writing serious historical biographies, his subjects were Germans from the same class he had come from, wealthy, cosmopolitan, intellectuals, who ended up serving Hitler. You don't have to be a psychoanalyst to make sense of these stories. They're Weitz's attempt to sort through the conflict between his love of his native Germany and his devastation about what his Germany had done.
It's long ago.
No, I know, but tell me.
Well, I was young and I could wear all sorts of clothes and make them look real.
In 1997, Weitz went on the Charlie Rose Show. He and Rose talked happily about Weitz's new biography, until Rose started to ask Weitz about Weitz's own experience during the war.
Did you go into Germany?
I was in Germany, yes.
Yeah, when?
After...
I'm going to pull this out of you, John.
The journalist.
Yes.
Weitz doesn't want to talk about it.
I started in France during the general time of the invasion plans.
Plans?
Yes.
They and dropped then, you by parachute into France?
No. Oh, never.
How'd you get in there?
You have many ways of being delivered, but not by parachute because they can see you coming.
Okay, so how'd you get in?
Oh, you can go in by boat.
Well, how did you
can go
get in
by a small plane.
How did you get in?
Well, by my small airplane.
Small airplane.
Small
that airplane. Landed.
But there were many beaches.
Okay. You could so land the small quietly. Plane landed on
you,
a beach.
You fly. You know, the dead stick is possible.
This goes on and on.
How many trips did you make in and out of France? 10?
Oh, God, no.
Less
no,
or more?
Oh, much less. Less. More than one, less than four. How's that? You're being the journalist.
All right.
Finally, Rose just gets exasperated.
Tell me why you're so, at this late stage,
because
what is the code?
Involved.
What is the code that keeps you from being more forthcoming?
Well, General Donovan issued a memorandum.
Wild Bill Donovan.
Yes, our boss.
Head of OSS.
Which said, for as long as there are people alive, I spoke to one the day before yesterday on the phone, an 89-year-old ex-colonel of Panzers, of Ahmed forces, Knight Cross wearer, who was a resistance officer. As long as there are people alive, you'd be amazed at how many Germans, stupid ones, would still be angry at somebody who brought some form of resistance.
This is 1997. The war has been over for more than half a century, and Weitz refuses to give anything more than the barest details of his experience because of a memo written by his former boss, who, by the way, has been dead for decades. Weitz and Adler are principled men. It's just that their principles take different forms. On matters of emotional significance, one man shrouds his memories in a blanket of chatter and whimsy. The other falls silent and retreats. When we encounter conflicts in memory, we want to label one party as a liar. We want to make a judgment. This strategy is authentic. This strategy is dubious. Adler is the egotistical one. Weitz is the evasive one. But why? Why can't we just accept that all of us deal with the uncertainty of our experiences in different ways? Memory does not reveal character. That's our mistake. In the early 1990s, John Weitz talked to a historian named Perry Bittescombe, who was working on a book about the werewolf movement. Bittescombe found Weitz's name in the phone book and called him out of the blue. This time, Weitz told yet another version of the raid. In this version, there was no shooting, no resistance, no one died. The members of Werewolf were all punks, too young to have fought in the war, full of false bravado. Weitz and his team of Allied soldiers surrounded the housing complex where the werewolf lived and arrested them. Then, and I'm quoting now from Bittescombe's notes, "The scene was invaded by forlorn mothers and grandmothers, each insisting that her lad was really a good boy and could not possibly be mixed up in this werewolf nastiness." Do you see what Weitz did? He took his version and combined it with Larry Adler's version. There were arrests and there were grandmothers. I have no idea whether it was conscious or not, but at the end of his life, Weitz decided that friendship was more important than memory. He decided not to be a memory fundamentalist. Larry Adler, for his part, gave his last concert in May of 2001 at the Royal Albert Hall. It was Prince Philip's 80th birthday celebration, and the Duke wanted his old friend to play for him. Adler was near the end. His son Peter knew he wasn't well.
No, he was ill. He was in hospital, and he, much to my horror, had himself checked out, and he was wheeled onto the stage at the Royal Albert Hall by a nurse in a wheelchair.
If the past is hazy and uncertain, then all you have is the present. That's what propelled Larry Adler, to seek his fortune on Broadway as a kid, to give the harmonica its due, to risk it all fighting McCarthy, to leave Ingrid Bergman in the early morning hours to go round up some Nazis. Even at the very end of his life, he wasn't going to stay in the hospital, was he? He privileged experiences over memories.
And he played the harmonica from the wheelchair and blew every other artist off the stage. And he was wheeled off to a standing ovation. He was looking straight into camera, and I'm sure at me, going, "You do not tell me what to do." And, you know, died a few days later.
I checked. He actually died 2.5 months later. Somewhere, Larry Adler is laughing.
Our long-term memory systems are made up of two different systems, the explicit and implicit memory systems. The explicit or declarative memory is made up of episodic and semantic memories, while the implicit or non-declarative memory are made up of procedural memories such as skills, priming, and classical conditioning. Episodic memory is the retention of information about the where, when, and what of life's happenings, such as how we remember the episodes of our life, very important information, events that have happened in our lives, whereas semantic memory is knowledge about the world and basic understandings. Procedural memory, on the other hand, is a type of implicit memory for specific skills. Sometimes this is misinterpreted or misrepresented as something called muscle memory. Priming is the activation of information that we already have in storage to help us remember information better. And finally, classical conditioning was discussed in chapter and module 5, and basically is a new way of interpreting a stimuli that was once neutral, but once it was paired with an unconditioned or unlearned stimulus, it got the ability or the power to have a conditioned response to that particular stimulus. Neuroscientists studying memory have been able to use MRIs and fMRIs to really get a good look at what happens in human memory. And so from this research, we know what parts of the brain have a big impact on the creation and the recollection of memories. We know that the frontal lobe is very important for episodic memory. We know the amygdala is very important for emotional memories. We know the temporal lobes are incredibly important for priming and explicit memories, as well as the cerebellum, which is also important for implicit memory. But one of the most important parts of the brain for memory is the hippocampus. And the hippocampus is important in explicit memory and priming. So it's important for those pieces of information that we explicitly know and for our ability to go get pieces of information that we need at a later time. The ability for humans to retain information is great, but if we weren't able to go and get those pieces of information, it's really a worthless endeavor. It would be like having tons of data on 3.5 floppy disks, but no computer that would be able to go and get that information. The information's there, but if you can't get to it, what good is it? There's two really effective ways of retrieving information, and there's two different processes by which we go through to get that information. One of those ways is called a retrieval, and that's where we go and we get information based upon cues and tasks. So in a fill-in-the-blank exam, you would be given a cue, such as a question, and you would have the task of going and getting the information and putting it onto the piece of paper or into the computer to answer the question. There's also a version of this called recognition, and this is the kind of test that most of my students just adore. It's the type of test that has multiple choices, and you're given multiple chances or multiple options to recognize the correct answer. And a lot of times these are a little bit easier because at least you have a guesser's chance to get the right answer, but sometimes the professor or the teacher will do something rather sinister that makes the recognition piece a little bit more difficult. And that's the infamous all of the above or none of the above option. Because if you have four options that are all valid answers, you know, well, one of these has to be correct, but if you have four options and then none of the above, you don't know if you absolutely have the right answer in front of you. Sometimes recognition introduces something called confounding variables. And this would be something like if I were to ask you to remember the name of all seven dwarves from Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. You can probably remember a few, but if I were to give you a list of options, and within that option list were answers like Papa, or Smiley, or Goofy, you might see those and immediately think, I remember a Goofy dwarf, I remember a Papa dwarf, but if you think about it, Goofy's a dog from Disney, and Papa's a Smurf, not a dwarf. So sometimes identifying from a recognition piece is not necessarily easier than recall.
Stop.